from Matthew chapter 14. Verses 13 to 21. Matthew 14, beginning with the 13th verse. Now, when Jesus heard this, he withdrew from there in a boat to a deserted place by himself. But when the crowds heard it, they followed him on foot from the towns. When he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion for them and cured their sick. When it was evening, the disciples came to him and said, "This is a deserted place, and the hour is now late. Send the crowds away so that they may go into the villages and buy food for themselves." Jesus said to them, "They need not go away. You give them something to eat." They replied, "We have nothing here but 5 loaves and 2 fish." And he said, "Bring them here to me." Then he ordered the crowds to sit down on the grass. Taking the 5 loaves and 2 fish, he looked up to heaven and blessed and broke the loaves and gave them to the disciples, and the disciples gave them to the crowds. And all ate and were filled. And they took up what was left over of the bread, broken pieces, 12 baskets. And those who ate were about 5,000 men, besides women and children. The word of God for the people of God.
Thanks be to God.
We hear bad news all the time. I mean, it's a daily barrage. There's another plane crash, an outbreak of disease, more war, famine, people not having access to clean water. Have I depressed you sufficiently yet? And it's tempting, it's really tempting to bury our heads in the sand and just not to pay attention to the great need that is out there. But Jesus had just received some pretty bad news before our passage starts today. He had just learned of the death of his cousin John the Baptist, the gruesome death of his cousin John the Baptist. And so he was in pain, he was sad. And he went out by himself to get away because he needed to. But he wasn't so far away that he couldn't hear what was going on. And when he senses he's needed, he comes back to shore. The disciples wanted to send away the crowds to get food for themselves. And we see Jesus saying, "You feed." He tells the disciples to feed them. And today we hear that command echoing down for us. You feed them. So we need to feed people not only physically, but spiritually. Not only spiritually, but physically. The two are intertwined. Because if you can't think about Jesus as well if you have an empty stomach. But we have to give them Jesus, too. And we don't know what we're going to do, how it's going to affect somebody, and who they're going to go on to affect, the ripples that come through. I think about my mom started a food pantry at one of my dad's churches, and it started off pretty slow, but it picked up, and the fruits of it that really showed were that the people who were being helped decided in turn to volunteer into a pantry. And so we didn't know that was going to happen. That was not a requirement for them to get the food. It's just once they were helped, they wanted to pass it on. And I think that's pretty amazing. And so we have to feed people physically and spiritually. We have to give them bread and water, but also living water. So I was looking at another passage that has some similar themes to it, and that's the passage of the woman at the well. That's in John 4. You guys remember that story? So what happens in that story? The woman, Jesus is there in the midday sun, and the woman comes, and she's drawing water. Jesus asks for a drink, and she's like, "You asking me? You're a Jew, I'm a Samaritan." But then Jesus says to her, "Everyone who drinks of this water will be thirsty again. But those who drink of the water that I water that I give them will become in them a spring of water gushing up to eternal life. And the woman said, give me this water so that I may never be thirsty. And then Jesus talks to her some more, and he says to go and call her husband, right? But we learned quickly, and Jesus already knew, that she'd been married 5 times, and the man she was with was not her husband. And Jesus knew that, and he tells that, and so she's like, oh, you're a prophet. But he eventually reveals to her that he is the Messiah, and she's the first one that it gets revealed to outside of his disciples. And she goes on to tell everyone in her town about a man who told her everything, he knew everything about her, and she converted so many people. And it was just this one woman and the ripple effects that she had. So what can we learn from that story where Jesus gives the woman living water? Many of the unchurched people we encounter are like the Samaritan woman. They may have some limited familiarity with the Bible, but more than likely not a deep one. They may be on the outskirts of society. They may be out of control in some way, but they are still children of God, and we are called to make our church their church as well. So how do we offer them living water? George Hunter, in his book Radical Outreach, offers 5 approaches to reaching people like the Samaritan woman. And he bases this off of how Jesus did it. So first, we have to begin where the people are, not where we want them to be. Jesus began where the Samaritan woman was, her ancestry, her domestic history, her struggles, questions, and issues. Second, we have to engage in the ministry of conversation. Jesus engages in an extensive and wide-ranging conversation with the woman. Thirdly, we have to speak the people's language. Jesus doesn't talk up here to her. He uses everyday language, and he employs analogies that she can understand with living water. And fourthly, Jesus treated the woman with respect. And we have to treat everyone with respect, no matter what their past is or their social status. And finally, Jesus listened, responded, and related to the Samaritan woman with understanding. People can't hear until they've been heard. So we have to listen to people first. If we make the effort to understand them, they may risk believing that God understands them too. If we show them God's love, if we show them our love, they might dare to believe God could love them too. And Jesus does all these 5 things in our main passage too. We don't get all the details of the one-on-one encounters, but we know they're there. He's healing people all day long. He's talking to a lot of people. And he came to the shore in the first place because he was listening to the people and responding to their needs. And he instructs the disciples to act the same way when he tells them to feed the crowds. Jesus commands his disciples and us to follow his footsteps. If we love him, we will feed his sheep, both physically and spiritually. Another thing I wanted to talk about in our main passage today of the multiplying of the bread and fish is the obvious service parallels to Holy Communion. Jesus blesses and breaks the loaves, and this is what we do in communion. But there are deeper parallels, and it says the crowd is filled. Filled. They only have a little bit of food, but they're filled. And that made me think of communion. We only have a small amount of bread and juice, but it can fill us if we let it. It fills us spiritually and prepares us to go out into the world. So at that, in that time when the crowds left, it's interesting to think about what happened to them after they left, after Jesus had multiplied the bread and the loaves and they go on home. What happened? Are they more willing to share what they have with others? Do they go and tell all their friends and neighbors about it? Do they pass on the lessons they've received? We don't know what happened to these people, just as we may not know the effects of the works that we do in God's name, but God knows, and we can trust God to transform the world. This passage also shows us it's okay to admit when we're tired and need to get away, like Jesus going out on the boat. But we can't rest for too long. We've got to dig deeper and push harder and get back out there to doing God's work. We have to take care of our planet and all who inhabit it, because it isn't ours, it's God's, and we are to be stewards. This applies to how we handle our money and our natural resources, but it also applies to our gifts. Like good stewards of the manifold grace of God, serve one another with whatever gift each of you has received. That's 1 Peter. And it continues by saying, whoever speaks must do so as the one speaking the very words of God. Whoever serves must do so with the strength that God supplies, so that God may be glorified in all things through Jesus Christ. So I'm trying to tie a lot of themes together here, that the communion can feed us spiritually, and then we can go out with that renewed vigor and feed people spiritually and physically. Because when it comes down to it, God's hungry people can't wait too long for us to get our acts together before being fed. Because they're hungry right now. They're sick right now. They're being oppressed right now. So it's important they hear the good news of Jesus Christ right now, too. God has a vision, and we can't give up on it. He commanded his disciples to feed the multitudes, and he commands us today. We all know the verses, if you love me, feed my sheep. Matthew 25, what you did unto the least of these, you did unto me. It'll be harder for them to think about Jesus if all they can think about is their empty stomachs, like I said, so we have to feed them physically. But they still need Jesus. We have to give them Jesus and let them know that there is hope, that things can be better, that things will be better, that God has a plan and that we're a part of that plan. And how cool is that, that we get to participate in bringing God's kingdom more and more to fruition? There's an old saying that says we are the hands and feet of God. And God can do plenty on his own. I don't want to take away from his power, but he can and does use us if we let him. And when we offer our gifts up to him, he will multiply them. He will use them to further the kingdom. And we never know what we're going to do, how it will affect people down the road. Philippians tells us it is God who is at work in you, enabling you both to will and work for his good pleasure. We have no idea of knowing who the person we feed is going to touch, and who that person will tell about God's saving grace, and who that person will break bread with, and on and on. We have no way of knowing, but we can rest assured that God knows and sees all. And one day we'll get to see face to face too. And in the meantime, God will fortify us. He will feed us spiritually and give us the grace to do his work. And one way is through receiving Holy Communion, which we're going to do today. John Wesley considered Holy Communion a means of grace and thought that we should do it as often as possible, because it's something that Jesus commanded. Do this in remembrance of me. And not only should we do it because he commanded us to, but also because the benefits are so great, including the strengthening and the refreshing of our souls. The thief comes only to steal and kill and destroy, but Jesus came so that we may have life and have it abundantly. Jeremiah 29:11, for I know the plans I have for you, says the Lord, plans for your welfare and not for harm, plans to give you a future with hope. So there's a lot I'm trying to tie together, but basically, God will supply our needs and our spiritual needs, and then we are to go out and feed his people physically and spiritually. Let us pray. God of abundant grace and compassion, You heap blessings on us with the reminder that we have been blessed to be a blessing. This morning, we remember that we live in a world where so many don't have enough to eat or clean water to drink. And the words that Jesus spoke to the disciples ring loud in our ears. You give them something to eat. As we put our gifts in your hands and lift our